Okay. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Can I just check how many of you are in because your feet are tired and how many of you are in because you're coming to listen to what I've got to say? Okay. Excellent. Right. I want to talk to you this afternoon about the Transglobal Expedition going overland, which was a concept of going around the world and making a true circumnavigation of the planet. What I'm planning to do is to talk to you briefly, sort of outline what that was, why we did it, and then run through some highlights and some lowlights. And then I've got a few topics to cover off. But really, I think that the value of these inputs is to really meet your needs. So what I'd like to do first is, instead of doing the questions at the end and all people sit around a bit embarrassed about, you know, what shall I ask and nobody putting their hand up, can I just ask what you're interested in? You know, what do you want to get out of this sort of three quarters of an hour what we're going to spend together? What sorts of things would you love to get the answers to?
Shipping, visas, legal issues.
Okay. Shipping, visas and legal stuff. Okay.
Inspiration.
Inspiration.
Yes.
Okay. No pressure. Okay.
Useful kit to take and how to avoid crime and mishaps.
Oh, okay.
I'm particularly interested in the differences between an expedition or a trip that's 4 years compared with the sort of 6 months, 12 months.
Yeah. Yes, listen, that as we sort of open up. Okay, so we'll, at the very least we'll do is we'll touch on those things right at the end when we get to the questions bit, but I'll also cover off and we can go into any depth we want to as we go through. So my name's Paul Crittenden, and back in 2005, I had this idea that I'd take part in something called the Mongol Rally. Has anyone ever heard of that? An insane idea, but a lot of fun. Basically, it's a charity event where predominantly gap year students, travel across from London to Ulaanbaatar in Mongolia, inebriated most of the time, reckless all of the time, and accompanied each year by a handful of people who really ought to know better, and I was one of those people back then. And in 2007, we set off in an old Suzuki 4x4, and it took us 5 weeks to hurtle, and I kid you not, almost non-stop from London to Ulaanbaatar, finishing the last 700 miles with no breaks whatsoever across the Mongolian steppe. And it was great fun, but the problem with that kind of event is you don't meet anyone except fellow travellers, and you don't really get to see much other than the road in front because you daren't take your eyes off it. You're going that quickly. So I came back to the UK, and a few years later, I decided that I would set off on a trip, and it started being a three-month trip, as a lot of these longer trips do start out, as an idea to do something about 3 months long. And it very soon became clear, when we put the map on the dining room wall and started to put pins in it about the kind of place we'd like to visit, that was not going to be long enough. And it went from 3 months to 6 months to 9 months, and around about a year we started talking to parents saying, "You really okay?" Because my parents are quite elderly, or were. And you know, we start getting anxious about leaving family behind and going away and doing things that are selfish. So we had conversations then. Then it grew to 18 months. We felt quite comfortable with the idea of an 18-month trip. People were kind of supportive of that. It ended up being four and a half years. And that's because the first thing you learn when you start to do any kind of overlanding is that plans account for very little. And that the majority of your decisions are made up as you go. Although your intentions might be fairly solid when you set out. So the idea became that we would drive around the world. And I'm the kind of person who likes to set myself challenges. So instead of just driving around the world, we decided that we would try to do a full true circumnavigation. A true circumnavigation is one where you go around the world, but you meet some criteria. We're going to look at what they are. And the first two, the crucial ones, is that you drive through two antipodes, which means two points exactly opposite each other on the surface of the planet. And when you start looking at maps to do that in a vehicle, you soon discover there aren't very many places in the world where land is opposite land. And so the route becomes, to some degree, determined by those possibilities. So let me just talk to you about this. This runs a bit behind. So the expedition was It became an expedition rather than a trip when it became purposeful. The first thing we wanted to do was have a damn good time. I was at the time, I think, 54, 55, and I'm thinking, you know, if I don't do something quite ambitious now, I'm going to run out of time. So those of you that are younger than 55, my inspiration would be do it now, because as you get older, it gets more difficult in terms of your physical health. Then it became a true Serbian navigation. And what that means is you start and finish at the same point, you travel broadly in the same direction, and we went east from the UK. It means you must pass through those two antipodes, and of course that means that you're going to cross the equator at least twice, and you're going to go through every single line of longitude. The distance around the equator is roughly 40,000 kilometres, and it requires you to do that in one direction. So if you travel backwards at any point, you have to take that off. What made it an expedition was the fact that instead of just going on a jolly, we decided that we would engage about 20,000 school kids in the UK in learning a bit of truth about what is out there in the world. So before we left on expedition, we travelled around the UK and visited, I don't know, I think it was 35, 40 primary schools, and we got all those children involved, and then they talked to other kids, and it grew until there were about 20,000 children following the expedition for the first couple of years. Because remember, it was only going to be 18 months, and by the time we had got 2 years in, a lot of the kids we'd met had gone on to senior school, and they weren't able to follow us anyway. And we also raised awareness for three charities. We didn't raise money intentionally because we didn't want to be sidetracked into the whole sort of emotional and practical issues that that raises for us. But we were very happy to lend support to those charities by raising awareness as we travelled and during the school trip before we left. So there's a map in a way that you don't often see it. It's an antipodal map. So what it shows you, I don't know if this is going to work here. Oh, yes. These points, this is the antipodes. This is where we left. We went east across Europe to the first antipode, which was in northeastern Mongolia. That bit of the map is upside down. And then we went on from there, shipped from Vladivostok, around the top of China, shipped from Vladivostok into the States. Where is it? Over here. And then all the way down through the Americas to the second antipode, which is in southern Chile. And then we came up to Buenos Aires and shipped to South Africa and then came up through Africa. So five continents. Turned out to be about 115,000 kilometres, and it seems like a billion memories. Hundreds and hundreds of people that we now consider to be really good friends. In the process, we went through 42 countries, 8 deserts, 16 mountain ranges, went to the Arctic Circle in the north. We wanted to go higher, but we couldn't. There's a story there. Went to the world's southernmost city in Ushuaia in Argentina, the driest place on Earth. Anyone know where that is? Okay, the Atacama Desert, plus 57 centigrades. Anyone ever been that hot? Yeah, you don't want to do it too often. That was in Kazakhstan, and minus 30 degrees centigrade. Where do you think that was? Where? Nope. Montana, US. Yeah, and minus 30 in a roof tent is pretty chilly. Now, I'm a bit of an adventurous guy, and I like to take risks. I'm not risk-averse in any way, shape, or form. And we could have gone the easy way. We could have taken the tarmac roads often. We always chose, where we could, the off-road sections to travel between places. And quite often, we went where there were no roads. In one particular area, in northwestern Argentina, I'm fairly sure that no one had ever taken a vehicle between two points about 120 miles apart. We got stuck several times and we didn't see any evidence at all that any humans had ever gone that way. So it was really quite exciting. So I'm going to rush you through some pictures. We have so many, 60,000 pictures. How the hell do you choose, you know, a couple of dozen to show people on a thing like this? But this is an example of how society becomes more important to you as you travel. We were camped here in a riverbed, a dry riverbed in Mongolia, shortly after we entered in the west of the country, and we camped there. And these chaps rode through with some. They were driving horses through, and they stopped, and we gave them instant coffee, which I don't think they'd ever had before, and we took pictures. We also had a video camera running, and one of them saw the image on the video camera and couldn't understand how he was in this picture. Couldn't fathom how that would work. And we made quite good friends with these. They came through every day, driving the horses through. We were there for about a week. And eventually we became, you know, sort of expecting them through, and they expected their coffee, and we would have a laugh, even though we didn't speak the same language. And this is the kind of family you'll meet in Mongolia. This is their family yak here, towing they're actually moving home. They do this about four times a year. And this chap here, I don't know how old he was, maybe 14, and he had responsibility for moving house. I'm not sure how many times we would allow our 14-year-old kids to be in charge of that kind of thing. And this is a chap that I made friends with at the top of the pass in Mongolia. This, I can't see that probably, but that is a snuff bottle that he's handed me. This is a sign that they have accepted you as a friend. They'll give you some snuff. Now, I hate snuff, but quite often you have to go through some sort of rituals or some customs to be able to make connections with people when you travel, and sometimes it makes you sneeze, basically. Another way of building empathy is really get below people. So position matters. If you adopt the dominant stance in relationships when you're traveling, it can make people feel uneasy. So if you get down, and I'm doing this with some camels, and the story here is I met one camel, and I was interested and curious about this camel, and within about 15 or 20 minutes, camels came from everywhere. And eventually I was surrounded by this group of camels, and it was really quite a humbling experience to feel the power of that collective group of beasts. Just curious, and you can't see it on this because it's too pale, but the teenagers in this group would hide behind mum and dad and put their head between the humps so that their mum and dad was between me and them. It was really quite interesting. And we later on, I don't know if I've got the picture in here, but we later on broke down in Mongolia after not taking the advice of the locals. And when you're traveling, it's really important to listen to what you are told. And sometimes it's not told verbally, it's sort of gesticulations and pointing. We'd been told to avoid the bog from that riverbed, to drive around it. Now, to me, a bog is like, you know, 400 feet across, maybe a few hundred yards. This bog was about 20 miles across, and so obviously my scale was not calibrated to the locals, and we drove into the bog, and those same people that had taken coffee from us a week or so before came and dug us out of the bog. We didn't even know they were there. They just materialized out from the far distance, and suddenly one came, and then another one came on a horse, and then two more walked across, and before we knew it, there was about 12 people around digging, and they wouldn't let me dig. They took the spade and they dug us out the bog and they saw us on our way. We refer to that as the bog incident, not because they dug us out of the bog, but because in the process of them digging us out the bog, we left behind our portable toilet. Yeah. So I'm flashing through these a bit. This was in Siberia. Fabulous, fabulous place. It was completely different to what I expected. I expected in my mind, I pictured this sort of grey place, very drab and dreary and sort of, you know, old Russian. But in fact, it was just like, you know, New England in the fall. Actually, we arrived there around about September time. It was absolutely stunningly beautiful and a great place to explore. However, you can't see this very well. This is a picture down a track, deep in the forest. We've been told, those of you that have been over to our truck, was there's a story of this on one of the boards. We've been told by a young woman who worked in a mobile phone store in one of the shops we'd gone into, in one of the towns we'd gone to earlier on in Russia, that she'd always wanted to go to Lake Baikal because she had studied it in university but never actually been able to get there. And so we said, yes, okay, we'll go there for you and we'll send you some pictures in return for you helping us get this phone. She'd really put herself on the line for us getting this phone, because when you go to Russia, you're not allowed to have a local mobile phone unless you have a Russian passport. So she very kindly had taken out the phone in her name, taken on the bill in her name, on trust that we would pay the bill. So we was quite indebted to her, And so we were determined to get to Lake Baikal. And in doing that, we went through a forest where there was a very recent and very extensive amount of logging taking place. So instead of there being the one route marked on the track, right, marked on the map in red, there are about 150 of these routes. And we spent the good part of a day travelling through these routes, coming to dead ends, coming to trees fallen across the route, and backtracking, until it got about late, got quite late in the day, probably 5 o'clock, and we found this route, which looked, it went in the right direction, it looked the right amount of wear, it didn't look like a logging track, and so we went for it. And we found ourselves on this very steep incline with a very heavily loaded Land Rover, and we got up probably, I don't know, possibly a quarter of a mile before it steepened, and I guess it was going over the mountains to Lake Baikal. And it got so steep that the wheel started to spin, even though the diffs were locked. So I put the handbrake on, stopped, and we started to slide back down the hill. So instinctively, I looked in the mirrors, checked there was no one behind me, as you do, and realised that wasn't, you know, I wasn't going to be able to stop this thing sliding down the hill. So I swung the steering wheel and slewed it sideways to stop it, which is great, it stopped it. But it also meant we couldn't get going again. So we got out the winch rope, first use of the winch in the entire time, slung it around a tree stump, started a winch up, pulled the stump out of the ground. Wasn't expected, I didn't know what to do. So I tied it onto a younger tree, which looks a bit more healthily embedded in the ground, and snapped the tree. Put it on a third, and managed to get ourselves moved slightly up the hill. But in the process of starting up and sort of using the engine to help the winch, I'd forgotten to take the handbrake off. And because it's not like, you know, oh well, mirror signal maneuver. You know, it's all a bit of a chaos going on, and there's lots of power being put through the transmission, and it's all kind of working hands and feet together in a new situation on an incline where, you know, you get it wrong, you're going to slide down the hill. So it's quite high pressure. And I suddenly realized, damn, the handbrake's on. So I slung the handbrake off, at which point, of course, it put a shock load in through the transmission. It was a big bang, and we broke a half shaft in the rear axle. Now, cut a long story short, we managed to limp 70 miles back to a town called Gusinisursk. It's a town that's come up, built up around a power station. Everybody works in a power station. And we found a local mechanic. Actually, he found us, because when we checked into the local hotel, they asked what we were doing. We told them about the breakage. And at 8 o'clock that night, there's a knock on the door, and there was a guy from downstairs. He said, "The mechanic will see you now." And we were hailed to the mechanic at 8 o'clock at night. He worked on our truck until 3 o'clock in the morning, completely fixed the damn thing, and he did it for the price of a couple of beers. Should never forget him. And we then left. Now, when we were in Russia, we were on a 3-month business visa. Who wanted information on visas? Yeah, okay. So when you go to Russia, if you want to go in and out of Russia, so into the west, maybe into Kazakhstan, then into Russia again, to the middle Altai region, then back into Mongolia, and then than a single or double entry, okay? And you have to register and all sorts of things for being in the country. And we were under a lot of pressure to get all the way around the top of China to Vladivostok in time. So we left after this delay and made a mistake. And that mistake was, we drove after dark. Now, a lot of people said to me before, when I was getting ready to do this trip, you know, experts don't travel after dark. I could never understand why. Got headlights. I now know why. You cannot predict wild animals the same way you can oncoming traffic. Okay? And about 10:30, 10:20 that night, 7 wild horses ran across the road in front of us, and we took one out. Stove in the front of the car, cost us another week, and we had to sacrifice a leg of our Russian expedition because of that bad error of judgment. And if you come over to where the truck is, you'll see the story of that and see the pictures. We actually beat it back into the shape, in a Russian lockup garage with some two blocks of wood. There it is. Two blocks of wood and a couple of hammers. And there's me proudly looking at my handiwork halfway through, You'll notice, if any of Land Rover owners in here, or aspiring Land Rover owners, you'll notice the only tool I have is the gaffer tape down here. The WD-40 is behind me on the far fender there. Okay. So fast forward to the States, having shipped out of Vladivostok. Oh no, let's not fast forward to Vladivostok. Let's talk to you about fear. How many people in here are anxious about threats on the road? Dangers. Okay. So was I. I spent a lot of time thinking about what ifs. I've had an awful lot of disasters happen to me in life, most of which never actually happened. They just were imagined as happening. And you get all those feelings, you know, of anxiety and so on. And to give an example of how we sort of misinterpret or we can sort of export our fears and anxieties into environments, we had checked into a very cheap hostel in Vladivostok to wait for our shipping and booked it. It was going to be 2 weeks before we left. So we don't like cities much, so we said, okay, let's go out into the forests northeast of Vladivostok and we'll camp in the forest, we'll have some fun, you know, just chill out for a couple of weeks. So off we went, about 60 miles deep into a forest, nobody around, exactly the kind of place that we like. And we went off to sleep, I think it was the second night. And about midnight, my wife at the time was asleep. I was almost asleep, and then I heard the unmistakable sound of human footprints in frozen ground. And they stopped, and I woke up completely. 60 miles from anywhere, footprints outside, footsteps outside, and then I heard deep Russian male voices. Two men talking to each other. And then I heard, woo, 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 woo! And then a gunshot. Now, what would you have done at that time? All the men are going, wake the wife up. What I did was what you should do, which was leapt naked out of my duvet, not out of the tent, I'm not that brave, grabbed my knife, which I always keep in the knifery in the tent, and kneeled like this, protecting my woman, right? Who am I kidding? I was protecting myself. And after about 30 seconds of staying still, I realised there's only canvas between me and this shooter. And for the next, I don't know, 5 minutes maybe, I lay poised, ready for action, ready to defend myself. And then I heard the footprints again, footsteps. And then nothing. And what I learned that night were two things. First of all, my wife can sleep through anything because she had gone back to sleep. The second thing is this, that we export with us our fears and anxieties when we travel. We take our what-ifs that we have created in our world in the UK and we take them into other environments where things are very different. And I sent to on reflecting that, I realised what happened was that we were in hunting territory and two hunters had been out hunting at night, came across this white Land Rover with a roof tent on it and gone, what is that? What do you think it is? And then their dog had seen their quarry, barked at it, and they'd taken a go at it and then got on with their hunting. You see, people are not the way we project them to be. And someone said earlier on today in one of these speeches that you find that the majority of people around the world are good people who want to help you and are curious and will actually go out of their way to help you and to make your journey as good as it possibly can be. And it's very humbling to know that and to realise that in the UK often it's not like that. You know, if we broke down in a village in the UK, I don't think it would be very long before we're being asked how long we're going to be there and should we be somewhere else. So this is the Great Basin. Sorry, this is the Great Basin. It lags behind my click a bit. In Utah. And I didn't know this. A little factoid. How many of you have heard of the Pony Express? Okay, it went across Utah. How long do you think the Pony Express was in being for? How long do you think that ran for?
10 years.
10 years? 3 years. 3 years. It's a big deal, isn't it? Everyone has heard of the Wild West and the amazing service, but of course it was made completely obsolete by the telegraph and then the railways. So it only existed for a very short period of time. But we drove a large section of it across Utah. And it was really thrilling because it threads its way, as it would do, I suppose, past a lot of gold mines. And some of those gold mines are still in existence today. So what you do is you have to be very careful when you drive past them because they think they're coming to nick their gold. This is me sitting in the tent in Montana. I don't know if you can see it on this picture because of the illumination here, but you can see the ice creeping up the walls of the tent here on the inside. And when we woke up in the morning, after spending a night in the roof tent, there would be a quarter of an inch of ice on the inside of the tent, which we would fold up. All the ice would fall onto the duvet. Now here you'd go, you must be crazy, that's going to be soaking wet. It's so cold it doesn't melt, right? So in the morning you just open it up, brush it out, and go to bed again. Okay, and this is Utah again. This is a place called Lockhart Basin Road. Fabulous drive, runs broadly from Moab all the way south towards Arizona. Recommend it. You're not supposed to camp on this road because it's a protected area, but it's almost impossible to drive it in one day. So our policy was, okay, we'll stay in the same tracks we're driving on, put the roof tent up, won't walk off the path, and hope that no one catches us, basically. So we spent, this is the campsite, we spent roughly 750 nights in our rooftop tent. So if any of you are debating which rooftop tent to buy, or are curious about how they stand up, come over and have a look, because we've got one on the top of the car now that's been there for 750 nights and is still going strong. As we travelled south through the Americas, we got to a place called Bolivia, and we went onto the salt flats, the Salar de Uyuni. Anybody heard of that? It's the largest salt pan in the world, 12,500 square kilometres of just plain salt. There are two or three, they call them islands in the middle, largely because they are remnants of what used to be underwater when it was a sea. Often they're covered with cacti, but also remnants of barnacles and stuff and coral where they've dried up. Fascinating places, but you can see it's absolutely huge. And each year when the rains come, it becomes wet, and then when the sun comes out, dries the water and it becomes salt again. And we were using a map, pretty good map, a bit like an Ordnance Survey map, and it had the routes marked on it, but they were last year's routes. And of course, when the water comes and it melts all the salt, when it goes hard again, the routes are not always in the same place, and the locals know where they are because they test them out. Well, we followed a route south, almost directly south, from a place called Fish Island, towards what we were aiming for was the exit point off the Salar, and we hit the exit point. The problem was we hit it at 90 degrees. So it's a causeway of rock they've put out onto the Salar, which is supposed to come up from this direction, and we came from this direction. And when I saw it, this is exactly what went through my mind. Oh, there's some interesting rocks. Not there's the causeway, there's some interesting rocks. I better avoid them. So I steered between them to miss them. And about 200 feet further on, we broke through the surface of the Salar and came to a grinding halt, buried up to the chassis, in silt, because the salt was only about half an inch thick. Slimy silt underneath, the water table about 2 inches below the surface. And it took us 2 days to dig ourselves out of that problem. And it was one of those examples where you realise that the toolkit, of all the tools that you take with you on any kind of sizable trip, especially into remote locations, the most important tool is you. Because in those kinds of situations, there are really, you start off with one choice you have to make. In the very distant locations where the local tours don't go, where the local people don't travel, if you've broken down, you have to decide, am I going to die or not? Okay? The first decision, am I going to give up or not? Is this it or not? If the answer is no, then the next question is, am I trying to be rescued or survive? Okay? Because whichever strategy you take determines what you do. And we decided that we would rescue. And then we looked around and realized there's no one going to rescue us. And so we had to self-rescue. And the first thing I did, and I was David Bowyer, the guy who runs Goodwinch, I've got him to thank for this. I overheard him saying to someone else once, if you get into a winching situation, the first thing you have to do is make a cup of tea, right? Because a lot of winching challenges are screwed up because we rush at it. We try and overcome a problem quickly when actually we've got some time to stop and think. So we made a cup of tea and we thought about it. Now I thought about it in one way and my wife thought about it another way. My wife thought about it like this. Two skeletons, rusted defender. Okay? I thought about it this way. Really interesting challenge. I wonder how we're going to get out of this. And it really taught me that when I talked to her about that, I realized that you can look at things in very polarized ways. And the way you look at things when you travel is crucial to how, you know, to the outcome that you get. Because if you think about this is a doom and gloom situation, you tend to see the things that reinforce that view. Whereas when you look at things like this is an interesting challenge, you tend to see the things that would help you solve that challenge. So your mindset is, you know, one of the most critical tools that you take with you when you travel long distances, especially into remote locations. And self-recovery normally means using the equipment you've got to execute the perfect recovery process. So I did that. You know, I'd read about it. I'd never done this before, but on a Salar, we had a ground anchor. You whack the ground anchor into the ground. As you pull on it, it digs deeper. And then it bites, and then you pull your Land Rover out, having freed the wheels by digging them clear. On the Salar, that doesn't happen. What happens is this ground anchor just comes towards you like that. Your environment screams at you, think again, Buster. So we did. I went to bed that night, and I planted a question in my unconscious. Okay, what do I need to happen? Okay? And about 3 o'clock in the morning, my unconscious delivered me the answer, you need more grip in the Salar. So I got up, feeling quite optimistic. We unloaded a load of stuff out of the truck to make it lighter. We raised it by about half an inch. We dug more mud from underneath. Not enough, but we dug more mud from underneath. I went out in front of the car and I put the ground anchor in the ground again. And I cut a line in the salt so that the rope would be running through the salt, not on top of it. And I'd run a rope from there off diagonally and buried the spare wheel and did the same with that. Then I'd run another line off the other direction, dug another hole and put the barbecue in it. And I connected those with slots through the mud. And then I went beyond the barbecue because it wasn't a very big barbecue. And I dug a bollard like my old climbing days, a snow bollard in the snow. This was in salt and mud. And I put the tree strop around it. So we were trying to pull a huge lump of mud towards us. And then by doing that, we'd got enough traction. Sure enough, pull. I also doubled up the rope through a pulley, so that it was a very slow pull. And then I took everything out of the side lockers on the truck, took the shelves out, because I only had two sand ladders, and I put those under the front wheels of the truck, and I put the sand unders in the back of the truck, and by very slowly winching and very carefully driving, we managed to get out flat onto the salt end. Oh, and we'd lowered the tyres down to almost flat, so we were spreading the load. Now, that took us 2 days. At the end of that 2 days, or during that 2 days, I realized we'd also hold the diesel tank. So when I got down into the mud, I could smell diesel, and there was diesel dripping out of the tank. So we're now 500 miles from anywhere. We've got a hold diesel tank, and it's taken us 2 days to get out. Still don't know the way off the Salar. That day that we got out, was the shortest distance of our entire trip we traveled in one day, 150 meters. And we did it by driving 3 feet, then moving the boards in front of the wheels, then driving 3 feet, and then moving three. It took a lot of effort. And then moving all of the kit we'd unloaded from the car, the 150 metres, it must have been about 45 trips, to load it back into the car. So eventually we got off the Salar and we got away. You might be asking, how do we deal with a diesel leak? We didn't. Whenever we stopped, we put a cut down water bottle underneath, caught the diesel and put it back in the tank. So basically recycling it, and we calculated the rate of loss by measuring it on there, and we could calculate how much we were losing per hour of travel, and by that we could work out when we needed fuel. So that's the kind of sort of calculations that you might get used to doing when you're in this kind of environment. There's the Salar, and that's us stuck with a ground anchor about to be used for the first time, and that's camp. So it was quite cozy. When you look at that, you might think, oh, well, it's down in the ground. You know, it's a fairly straightforward recovery situation. What you don't remember, got to remember is this is at 14,000 feet. That's almost the level of base camp for Everest, right? So any physical work you do is exhausting. There's also no cloud. So the UV exposure is huge. And at night, because it's at that altitude, during the day it's sort of -2, -3. At night it drops very, very substantially. The only reason the water doesn't freeze is because it's so full of salt. So hazardous environments. Okay, what's coming next? Let me surprise myself. Oh yes, this is a clip. You can't really see that very well. It's a clip taken off of a video, again in Bolivia. I specifically asked my wife to get out of the car and go and film this so she wouldn't be in the car when I drove across this. This was essentially, at each end of this, there were two tree stumps buried in the bank, a cable, steel cable, strung between them, with planks laid on, tied on with bale wire. If you listen to the video that this clip comes from, this still comes from, you can hear the wood splintering as I drove across. We'd asked some workmen who were there at the beginning of the bridge, we'd pointed the car and said, it's okay. And they went, oh, they're not in the car. Okay. So, just to fly through some of the things, this was heading up towards the Andean crossing the... what's it place? Olympia, the Olympia Pass, just north of the capital there. This is northwestern Argentina. You can't get these kind of vistas and experiences if you sit in your armchair. How many of you are hoping to go on a trip in the future at some point? See your hand up. Okay, I'm going to share this with you. What do you think stands between you and taking that trip? Hands up.
Money.
Okay. You? You do. You stand between you and it. Yeah, okay. Anybody, what else do you think is standing in the way?
Yourself. Confidence.
Confidence, okay.
Home commitments.
Sorry?
Home commitments.
Home commitments. Yeah. Nope, none of those. In my experience, and it's happened more than once, the thing that stands in the way is you deciding to go. Or not. Because when you decide to go, you make it the priority. And then you work out how to deal with family commitments, how to deal with the money, how to deal with confidence. Until you decide, this is it, I'm going, why would you have those solutions? Okay? So making the decision to leave and putting a date on it has an enormous power in getting you aligned behind that ambition. I speak to a load of people who say, oh, I wish I could do what you've done. As if I'm kind of some privileged, you know, upper class, wealthy person. I'm not. I just decided one day I'm going to do this. And then everything else had to align behind that. And this is a crossing out in, go back to that. That's a crossing in Honduras. Come back to me. Or maybe not. I'll try it again. There it is. A raft crossing on Honduras. The fear thing again. What we don't know about can't scare us. Right? So when we went to Honduras, we decided it was one of those situations where we were running out of money. Long story behind it, won't cut to that, but we were running out of money, which we did 6 times during this trip. We said, okay, what do we do? We need to find a place where we don't have to spend money. That means camping wild, eating local, staying still. So we wound our way through the tracks and by tracks, back tracks of Honduras to a place called Mosquitia. It's on the coast, the Caribbean coast, in the northeastern part of Honduras. And it's about 400 meters wide, this beach. You've got primary rainforest behind you and you've got the Caribbean in front of you, idyllic kind of place. It also happens to have the highest homicide rate in the world. We didn't know that until we got to Managua. We camped there for 5 nights. While we camped there, we were actually on the very edge of the eye of Hurricane Henry. We almost lost the car and the tent. But we also met the locals. They came along on their horses and they got interested. We saw lots of traffic going past in pickups piled high. Didn't quite know what that was. We now know it's probably drug runners bringing their stuff along the coast, because that's who kills each other and comes through there. But the only crime we experienced there was a few kids who'd come and sat with us for two or three days, and one day, just before we left, we noticed our cooking oil was missing. Here's another a lesson for us. I thought, buggers, they've nicked my oil. So next time I saw them, I shouted, okay, and they ran, because they knew why we were shouting at them. And I was kind of cussing and thinking, oh, damn, bloody kids are the same everywhere. And then I spotted one of them. And I didn't do anything. I sat and I thought, well, how do I handle this? And I had a sort of moment of inspiration. I called out in Spanish, I thought we were friends. His face dropped. And he stood, he looked ashamed. And he walked a little bit closer. And then a little bit closer. And I said, you stole from me. I thought we were friends. What do you think he said? Stole it from my mum. I said, okay. Why did you want your mum to? We don't have any oil. Okay. Can I have my bottle back? I didn't care about the oil. It was a polycarbonate bottle that I was annoyed about. So he went off and he bought the bottle back. Do you know what he said? Can we still be friends? Right? You see, in third world countries, often people, in fact, always, people do what's necessary to get by, including stealing from people who they think are not going to be that offended, not going to do much about it. So those of us that worry about security, the people that you need to think about most are the criminal element, and there are very few of those, and the needy, who see you as wealthy and want some of what you've got. Okay? And my response to that is get close to those people who are needy, because the most valuable thing you can give them is some of your time and a bit of your heart, and stay away from the ones who look like they're going to cause you grief. Okay. Coming up through Africa, this is in Zambia. Looks like a true expedition shot, that, doesn't it? We had to pose it. We had to, you know, send the car down the road, get on telephone to set it up. Namibia, the dunes at Sossifly. If you go there and you walk up this dune, credit to you. It's a hell of a long way and up sand. Bugs. Any of you scared of spiders? If you're going to travel, you need to get over that. And moths and other wiggly creatures, because they'll find their way into everything you've got. And you cannot survive at night without them coming visiting. Because as soon as they see your light, they head for you. I'm actually reading a book here, and there's one of them perched on the side of my face. After a while, you just don't even notice the bugs flying around and stuff. So, you know, just relax into it. Very few of them bite. A few do, and you'll be able to know who they are. The mosquitoes are the worst. But very few of them do. However, you can't escape the real and present danger in Africa of wild animals. I think it's a shame, in a way, that so many safaris are now commercialising that part of our wonderful planet and taking people out close into these spaces where the animals begin to learn that, you know, these are tourists and we can get close and so on, and they're not dangerous. We're not dangerous to them. But they become dangerous when they learn what's in it for them. And we were parked in a campsite in a national park in Botswana, and at 6 o'clock in the morning we were rudely awoken by the sound of baboons. Do you know what a baboon sounds like? Pretty noisy. Do you know what they sound like 6 feet from your ear? Bloody terrifying. Especially when they go like this. And then they all start. And there's 12, 15, 20 of them all doing the same thing. And it's even more terrifying when a 4-inch thick branch then hits your tent, because they are bright enough to realise that there might be stuff in that tent that's good to eat, and you're in it between them and the food. And what they did that morning was they started to throw things. They would bite off or break off a branch and throw it. And this is actually something called a sausage tree, the fruit of which is about this long and about this big and weighs about 3.5 kilos. That's one of them. And they were taking these fruit from the tree They eat them, but they would take a couple of bites and they'd throw it at the tent. And eventually, you have to do something. You can't just wait until they get fed up. So we ended up getting out of the tent on a plan. Remember, plans don't go according to plan. So down the front, round to the side, unlock the door, get the weapons. The machete and the rounder's bat. If ever I get close enough to a baboon to hit him with a rounder's bat, I know I've lost the fight. Okay? Because they got huge teeth, very strong, very fast, and no fear. So I made a lot of noise, slapping this machete against the side of the truck, waving things around, and the baboons, of course, did absolutely nothing. They just sat there looking at me as, who's this idiot? There's 20 of us. And they stayed their ground, and the more noise we make, the more agitated they become, as if, you know, how are we going to get to this stuff? And then suddenly, a baboon rushed through camp, plucking a Tupperware container full of eggs. They knew there were eggs in there. How did they do that? Tupperware container full of eggs, straight up a tree, opened it up, ate the eggs, threw the Tupperware away. If you go to Botswana or any African state where there's a national park, the local animals like that, the baboons, the monkeys, they've learned how to undo zips, how to undo car doors, okay? They're almost in a position where they can come and infiltrate your camp like the SAS. So that's the only time we've been attacked by animals on the trip. And just to give you just a flash of some of the things that we were able to see in Africa, you really can get up close to this wildlife. And if you're into wildlife, I would suggest that a trip to Africa or through Africa at some point is an absolute must. This amazing male lion was maybe 15 feet from our car. And of course, the local people are curious, they're poor, and they are needy. And they will come to you and they will, first of all, try to beg things from you, then they'll try to sell you things, and then if you can't get something from them, they'll often try to steal it from you. And it's not because they're criminals. It's because they truly are poor. We talk about the poor in England, we have no idea what it's like for these people. And just to show how different our worlds are, through this picture up, this chap on the left here to you, this chap, they were herding a group of camels, about 100 camels, through the savannah. And when they saw us, they stopped and they walked towards us with the spears. And learning by now that that's not a threat, I'd stop the car, smiled at them and waved them over, and we had this kind of exchange, not in language but in gesture. And I went like this, would you like a drink? I reached behind me and undid the fridge, took out a can of Coke. I handed it to him and he reached out and he picked it, he dropped it like that. He'd never felt anything that cold. You know, there are places on this planet where people live in ways we cannot comprehend. They live without the things that we take for granted every single day, and that's the magic of travel. That we learn to open our mind up and see things and experience things that we would never otherwise see and experience. And hopefully we learn. This is a shot of the Kibera. Anybody know where that is? It's in Kenya. What's the capital of Kenya? Nairobi. Okay. This is a second largest slum in the world. It's in the center of Nairobi. It's about 5% of the land mass of the city, and it takes well over half of the population. Okay. There's no sanitation, no legal electricity, no legal running water. The government, in fact, insists it doesn't exist, has no legal status. We visited a school there called the Girls Soccer Academy, and we wound our way through these streets. The streets are covered in garbage, often ankle deep. There is a constant stench of human excrement, and life goes on around it. There are cobblers, there are bicycle repair people, there are, you know, estate agents selling access to, you know, rental on huts. There are, you know, carpenters and electricians, and just like the same kind of people you would meet in a city or a town in our country, they're in Kibera, except they live in absolute poverty. And one of the most inspiring things I saw was a hand-painted message on a mud hut, on the wall of a mud hut, and it said, "Don't look at the problems. Look at the solutions. No, look at the possibilities." And I saw that as we were on the way to this school. And then when I went into the school, the head teacher came to me and he said, really glad that you're coming to see us. We're trying to raise some money to build some residential space. Would you mind, you know, coming and having a look around and see if you can donate something? And we ended up sitting in his little office. It was probably 6 by 8, maybe. Mud floor. And I said, so what are your problems? He said, well, this month, we haven't been able to afford any sanitary towels. I said, what do you mean? You haven't been able to afford sanitary towels? It's a school. He said, yeah. He said, but you have to understand that it's a girls' school. And if we can't supply sanitary towels, or if the girls can't have sanitary towels, they can't come to school. Or they don't want to come to school. And because they want to come to school so much, they want to get sanitary towels. So they sell their bodies in order to get sanitary towels. Then they get pregnant, then they can't come to school anyway. Okay? I emptied my pockets. I gave them 60,000 shillings there and then. And that's not a lot of money, by the way. It's as much as I had in my pockets. So the world out there is just like ours, except it's not. And I think it's important when we travel that we bear in mind that it's not just about take. It's not just about what we can get from our travel. It's not about the experiences we want to have. It's about, you know, what we can put back and how we can do that. How are we doing? Right. I'm not sure I'm going to follow this through. What were the questions before? Transport, shipping, nightmare. Yeah. Sorry. Some simple words of advice. One, if you can, always go containered. If you go row-row, that's roll-on, roll-off, like a ferry, inevitably something will get taken off your vehicle. Your vehicle is normally on a ship for a long time. The ship's staff are poorly paid. It's that situation. People have got nothing. You've got lots. They want to unbolt something from your car to sell it. Very few people I know have row-rowed their ship from one continent to another, one place to another, and not had damage or theft. And of course, when you go on row-row, inevitably you have to give them the key so they can move it around in the ship if they need to, so there's access to your vehicle. Containerized, if you can. Share it with other people if you can. That cuts the cost down. Think about your vehicle in terms of height. You can get a high rooftop, high cube container, which is slightly higher, which means you can get a Land Rover with roof tent inside, but you can only get them in 40-foot containers, so you have to rent a 40-foot instead of 20-foot. The shipping, arrange it in advance if you can, but not too far in advance, so maybe 2-3 weeks, because that's when you'll get a decent price, and invariably the schedules for shipping shift quite a lot, so it's really difficult to actually pre-plan it in advance of that anyway. A lot of shipping agents won't accept your booking that, you know, much further in advance than that. What else did you want to know about shipping?
Oh, we've done it several times. I wanted to know if you had secret answers.
Yeah, a local fixer is a local fixer is a good, an experienced local fixer. We knew one we had one in Vladivostok called Yuri. I'm absolutely convinced he was mafia. When I asked him, you know, there's a section on the shipping form that says, where are you containerizing the location? He said, we have the place. Okay. Do you want cash or check or cut? Cash. Yeah. But he was completely trustworthy because no one would cross him. So, you know, you'd have to work with the locals on that. Yours was about anxieties, was it? Fears?
And criminality and other mishaps like crashes and stuff.
Yeah, okay. Well, what about crashes?
Did he have any experience of accidents?
Yeah, hitting the horse in Russia. 12 hours stationary a week, 12 hours on site stationary. Russian police came, provided an interpreter. Wouldn't have been better in the UK. Probably wouldn't have been as good in the UK if a Russian had crashed here. They wouldn't have got an interpreter, I'm sure. They made sure we were safe. The only thing is there's no recovery system in eastern Russia, so you're on your own. You're 70 miles to the next town. That's just tough. And they'll say to you, to get documentation that we've investigated this, you have to get to that town to get it, the paperwork, because they don't issue it on the spot. So, you know, you have to find a way of getting there. We actually just limped 400 metres at a time, filling up with water, till we got there. And true to their word, they'd left the paperwork. So everything is, you know, pretty much above board. Other places, if you have an accident, Central America, not quite so straightforward. You'll probably try and get ripped off and bribed by the police. Lot of corruption in Central and South America, but less so. It's getting less and less because governments are realising it affects tourism and travel. Even in places like Mongolia, we got ripped off in Mongolia by the police. So crashes, it just will go as it will. Always be your best self, right? Don't get aggressive, don't get adamant, don't get, you know, all the rest of it. Just be calm and rational and be polite and just stand your ground, basically. Violence and worry about, you know, stuff like that. We were told don't go to Mexico by Mexicans. Don't go to Colombia. Don't go into Ethiopia because you'll get stones thrown at your vehicle and all sorts of stuff. We had one stone thrown at us in Ethiopia, no trouble anywhere else, although we were moved on by what we think were drug runners in Mexico. But you've got to remember, they have no interest in hurting you. They've got interest in you not being there. They will just want a clear space to run the drugs, okay? So if you're in the way and they say you move. You don't say, why should I? You just, you know, be compliant and you'll be fine, inevitably. I mean, there are some times when that doesn't happen, but hopefully few and far between. Let me just blacken that out. Yeah. Other questions? What was the question at the back there somebody raised? How do you? Well, I'm not another overlander, so it's difficult for me to know that. But I will tell you this. When we left the UK, we travelled through Eastern Europe into Kazakhstan, Mongolia, and into Russia. By the time we got to Russia, we realised we'd changed the way we were talking. Through those countries, we had talked about what we're going to do after the trip. Okay? That was what was on our mind. We would talk about that a lot. Oh, this is changing us, isn't it? You know, what we could do after the trip. By the time we got to Vladivostok, we're no longer doing that because we had shifted from being on a trip to being on the road. So the next thing, you know, we found our conversations were about what we'd do tomorrow, where we're going next, not what we're going to do when we get home. And then we moved into America, and that was the first time that we actually ran out of money. We exited the port of Seattle with $15 and half a tank of gas. Well, the first thing you do is remember, make a decision. Are we giving up or not? We said no, so then it's okay, so I have earned some money. But at that point, the shift in thinking was, so now we have to earn money on the road. And the way we did it through America was I contacted all the Land Rover dealerships in the Western states and offered them a day of my time and my Expedition Land Rover to show their customers what you can do with a Land Rover. And out of the 60-odd that we contacted, two said yes. We pitched up for a day. We did a fantastic job of it. We did a video and we did, you know, talks and stuff. Showed people around the camp and told them what you could do and shared maps and stuff. And they paid us good money to do that. And then we got to San Diego. We met a car club and one of their owners had a Series 2 Land Rover. And they'd had it rewired. And when they connected the battery, all the wires melted. So they said, can you rewire a Land Rover? And I went, yeah, of course I can. Optimism is another thing you have to take with you on the road. And so that night I went on the internet, on his internet actually, and looked up how to rewire a Land Rover and got a wiring diagram and immediately realised what the problem was, that they had left the voltage regulator in place when they changed it to an alternator. I thought back to my mini days when I was a lad, you have to change that out. And so I did it and it worked perfectly and I got paid well for that too. So that's how we made money on the road. And I think that the message about making money on the road is really quite simple. You either stop and work, or you find a way of matching your transferable skills and what you have to a market. And then you do that at high price, low frequency. Because the last thing I want to do is stay for 6 months in a place working in a cafe to earn enough money to run for a month. You know, it's just not how I want to travel. So yeah, innovative ways really about making money. I don't recommend selling your body. It's probably not Probably not a good idea. I mean, you know, after death, not before death. So yeah, because at my age, you probably won't get a very good price for it anyway. Two things. First of all, the internet's still there when you're traveling. It's harder to get to. So internet cafes with insanely slow connections. Sometimes you can get a mobile phone tariff on a local phone that will give you data. It's often quite expensive, but probably inevitable. But internet cafes mainly. And I have a Land Rover, so the Land Rover network is amazing. We broke down in Ecuador, the transfer box collapsed basically because of that problem with the half shaft. When that went, we damaged the differential in the transfer box. In Ecuador, it blew up. We stayed in a village there for 7 weeks. They welcomed us with open arms. We became part of the village for 7 weeks. They had one PC, antiquated PC, linked to the internet when the weather was okay. But by using that internet connection, I managed to contact some people we'd met in Utah who shipped us used transmission box parts to Ecuador, and I drove got the local bus into Quito to pick them up, came back, rebuilt the transfer box in the car park at a local church. So, you know, research is more difficult, but, you know, persistence and time are in more, you know, are more available to you. Okay. From here to South Africa, so all the way around as far as South Africa, we use a marine GPS, which just basically allows you to put data points in and show your path, your track, and paper maps. I actually prefer paper maps to anything else because you can see the bigger picture. And the GPS, the marine GPS, are really important in remote locations because you can backtrack, you can see which way you've gone. And it's also possible to do a dead reckoning sort of navigation by putting points in located off your map. When we got to South Africa, we got tracks for Africa. And it was actually quite disappointing to be following a GPS. You know, it didn't feel quite so much of an adventure. So yeah, that was how we did it.
You had a fixer. Somebody you, obviously, you contacted to.
Yeah. Again, off of the contacts network. Anyone been through Vlad? Anyone know a shipping agent? Blah, 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 blah. And normally people say, yeah, this guy's great. And if you get five or six people saying this guy's great, that's the one to use.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
Did you have a list of shipping agents that you would contact 2 weeks
before? Same thing. You would go on the network and say, who's shipped out of this port before? You get, you know, half a dozen or more people come back. And if there's a name that keeps coming up, you know that person's probably going to be the one. In terms of price, don't always go for the cheapest. Unless you have to. Because often the cheapest, you know, will do less for you. It's an absolute godsend if you can turn up at the port gate and be walked through the process by someone who knows the guy in the offices, who deals with them all the time, you know, rubber stamps your process all the way through, expedites that a huge amount. In crossing from Panama into Colombia, we did it ourselves. We did it a group of four people sharing two containers. It took us 4 days walking around all the offices and that you turn up at a place and they'd say, "This, you need 5 photocopies, you've only got 4. It's a photocopier, can we just, no. Go away, come back when you've got 5. You know.
How flexible was your whole route? When you set out, did you have pretty well a rough idea of the whole route?
No, if you look at the car, there's a map on the door and it's got a around it. Yeah. Essentially, we said, they are the countries and that looks like the most interesting, when you look at a topographical map, you can see the most interesting wild places. So we kind of wiggled it around the country through those. But there was we didn't do any research of, oh, let's go to that city, then this city, between these points. And no, none of that. We did that once we got to the country. We'd stop for, you know, a couple of days to gather our senses and stuff and just say, okay, let's do this route, this looks interesting. And then, yeah, normally. And then quite often we'd get to a place and go, this is a bit disappointing, it's not wild enough. Let's try that way instead. So, you know, we only backtrack a couple of times, but quite often we'd divert off and do different things. Right at the back.
Do you totally ignore the possibility of a major health problem, or do you try and get some sort of cover?
Okay, that's, we're in the UK, it'll only last 12 months. If you try to extend that whilst you're out of the country, they don't want to know. Unless you go to a very expensive broker. So we travelled for 12 months with full remote area recovery, helicopters in, you know, marines and everything kind of cover, and then had nothing for the rest of the trip.
Yeah. Who did you have those first 12 months?
The British Mountaineering Council.
Yeah,
because they have, their experts are flying into places like Base Camp of Everest and stuff, you know, so they can get you out from there, they can get you out from pretty much anywhere. So that's what we did.
Okay.
Yeah. I think the most important thing about safety is, you know, in the UK, we are now a nation that lives in our phone. We have no idea what's going on around us most of the time. If you're going to travel, you need to just flip that. You only go to your phone when you want to make a phone call. And raise your awareness of what's going on around you, because that's your best protection against getting into harm. You know, learn to read mood, learn to read people's faces, learn to read situations, and you'll be fine. Yeah. You can't eliminate it completely, just as you can't eliminate it completely here.
Do you think the internet in many ways has taken away the adventure?
No. No. Because, I mean, true adventure, you know, going places for the first time, probably. And that's why I seek those places out when I travel, because they're rare. But no, I mean, it's when you're on that sailor off the beaten track, trust me, it feels like an adventure. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when you're deep in a rainforest and you can hear the frogs and the insects clicking at night and there's nothing else but that, it feels like an adventure. Or when you're passing over a high altitude mountain pass and the engine is only just managing to move your vehicle, it feels like an adventure. Yeah. Okay. But I think that I think the thing is that when you've travelled extensively, especially for a long time, when you come back, you're a completely different person. And what I mean by that is, you sitting here, if you've not travelled extensively, looking out at the rest of the world, you see it in a way that you've been encouraged to see it. But when you go there, you'll experience it the way it really is. And your perceptions of that will inevitably shift. And when you look back at the UK from those places, your perception of home will change too. Okay, so your paradigms, the way you experience things around you, will be different when you return. And it does make it a challenge to get back into life as we know it. And in fact, I'm not sure you ever quite do.
What do you wish you'd known before you went? And what did you have intuitively that you thought would be helpful, that was confirmed to be correct, sort of a hunch?
Okay. Can I do the second one first and then come back and ask you what the first one was? Because the second one's an easy ask for me. I intuitively knew that I had what it takes, come what may. Deep down. You know, there were things I was scared of, apprehensive about. You know, I was terrified of not learning languages, not being able to communicate. I was terrified of, you know, not really being able to get what I wanted to happen. I'm quite a control freak, so I like to have things my way. And you learn to be a bit more accommodating of other things. The first one was,
what did you learn that you wish you'd known before you set up?
Can I show you this?
Yeah.
Can I show you all this? Mm-hmm. Hold your hand up for me. Okay, hold it as still as you can. Pretty good. Now wave it. No, that's not the lesson. Hold it still. Now try to wave it. No, that's waving it. In life, there is no try. That's what I learned. You're either doing it or you're not. And that's why deciding is so critical. You're either going to do it or you're not going to do it. Don't pretend you're going to do it. Okay?
Full time. So I may have sold my house, I've obviously given up my job,
Well, I think when we left, it was an 18-month trip, and it evolved into something longer. And I think, yes, there's a different mindset. I think that if you're going away for a short period of time, you have conversations with yourself like, you know, I was self-employed. Will my client list still be active when I get back? Will they still want me? How old will I be? How will I want to be living? Whereas when you do a longer trip, you don't do any of that. You say, this is a period in my life where I'm living on the road. Okay, so it's a different set of expectations, it's a different set of priorities, different set of everything, really. So I think that if you're going for a very long time, the mindset to take is, this is an era in my life when I'm going to be mobile, like a nomad. Whereas if you go on a six-month trip, it's, you know, I've got a trip, I need to set what I can into that, and let's engineer it so that happens. So I think it's a different mindset. Yeah. Couple more.
What made you come back to the UK? Two
things. One, to finish, because remember we'd set up to do the circumnavigation. That was really important to me. And the reason that was really important to me, I'll be very honest with you, is I'd never finished anything in my life. So there was one priority why I needed to finish that trip, come what may. But the second thing is, you know, as that became likely, I start to think, what next? You know, how do I survive when I get back to, you know, the UK, where I can't survive on 31 quid a day, which is what it cost us overall to do this trip. So we started thinking about work. Then I got an opportunity for work. So it became like a snowball. You know, it gathered pace and became magnetic. We couldn't really do anything else. Your question?
What about your interaction with the Land Rover buddies and all this network you've got? I've been told by another guy who does quite a lot of long-distance driving that Facebook and this was a must.
Absolutely.
I hate the thing.
Yeah, I hate it too.
You have to have it because you have to network with everybody when you're out there. You press a button, even if you've got a very slow network, somebody will go, I love you.
Yeah. Unfortunately, you know, my name's Paul. I'm a Facebook addict. Right. Back in the UK, it's addictive. On the road, it's essential because it is the network connector for people. And if you're on a motorcycle, it's the hub. Cool, listen, now we're conscious I'm probably overrun by a long time. We're parked over there, going to be here all day tomorrow. If you want to come and have a chat, have a coffee, find out what I'm doing next, because I'm actually doing some stuff for Overlanders next in terms of how I earn my money, some exciting things. So please come over and have a chat.
We were speaking earlier about travel.
Yep. Yeah.
Now, I don't know if I did mention to you that in 1989, my sister-in-law in Zimbabwe, her daughter was to be married, and would my daughter be a bridesmaid? And we'd never travelled, but we set off for Zimbabwe singing, "We're all going to Zimbabwe." And that was the beginning of a travelling period that has been very...
Yeah.
And I've written a poem. And it's triggered by the fact that my granddaughter, first one is born, of my daughter who was a bridesmaid, and I can only describe her as stardust. And you realise we're all born with this stardust, the energy to take us through life, and how it can be eroded by others, and we are not following our true destiny. And I've written a poem, which if you did have a moment, I'd like...
Please do. If you're okay with that?
Yeah.
Go for it.
Okay.
Yeah. Center stage. If you stand close to this, they'll get it a bit louder.
Right. Okay. So this is stardust after my granddaughter. I see her there as stardust. But I realise we all have this stardust and we mustn't let it be eroded. We must use this to take us through our life. And I've just come to reading Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance again. I tried before, but with traveling, I now understand the book more. And he says that the best writing comes when you're not trying. Don't try to do this writing. Just be quiet, be at one, and it just comes out. So I thought, okay, I'll get a speak text and I'll speak it. and out came this. So I'd like to read it to you, if you don't mind. Stardust. The journey starts, and off we bound. Though hard to see our way around, but soon we find more even ground, and there begin to hear our sound. The way is clear, it's straight ahead. No problems can we see, but others say it's not that way, and they do not agree. So turns are taken left and right, and time is wasted so. If only they would trust in us the way we need to go. We travel more uncertain ways to fit within the bounds. By markers, showing all along, not listening to our sounds. The road is curved and weight bears down by people watching all around. Our light still shines to show our light still shines to show us on, but time is going, gone. So now we travel to please the crowd. The way we want is not allowed. Our stardust all is blown away. We just become another day.
Good man. Well done. Loved it. Okay, thanks, guys. I think we've well overrun my slot, so apologise that for the following speaker. Like I said, do come over and have a chat if you want to. Loads more to share with you. Sorry about that.
That's all right. That was excellent. That was my best talk of the day.
Really?